Okay, then welcome to the next talk, which is about production grade cell broadcast. You will see I have removed the production grade from the slide if you pay close attention to the schedule. So this is about cell broadcast in Osmocom. We'll quickly look at cell broadcast in general and also what this project is about and what we can expect from it. So in classic GSM, we... Oh, control plus is difficult to reach. In classic GSM, most channels are point-to-point, so we have an SDCCH, a TCH, all that stuff is point-to-point. It's between one phone and one network, and there is no point-to-multipoint communication, with some very rare exceptions. Of course, there's the BCCH, but that's not really containing any user information. It's only for internal management. We also have the VGCS and VBS. Actually, I should put all those acronyms and ask you guys what it means. So what's the MBMS, by the way? Who knows what the MBMS is? Acronym. Multimedia Broadcast. I'm not sure if Massive Messaging System, but Multimedia Broadcast for sure, yes. But I'm not sure about the second M, but yeah. Okay, so the VGCS VBS is voice group and broadcast calls, which only exist in railway GSM, but not in normal GSM networks, where we actually have TCH, like a downlink TCH that is received by multiple phones. I really love it, but it's unfortunately not supported by many phones. So it would be really nice to play with that, but it doesn't really exist outside of railway. And MBMS is multimedia, basically it's IP multicast for packet switched. But it was specified for 2G and 3G, but never deployed there. And now I think it's sort of more on the agenda for 4G and 5G again. And actually broadcasters are looking into that as a new way of broadcasting TV over 5G. I'm not sure what kind of sense that makes, but that's not my position to comment on. So the only way to really broadcast information to many subscribers at once is the cell broadcast mechanism, which is officially called SMSCB, the Short Message Service Cell Broadcast, which means the short message service that we all mention as SMS is actually, according to the spec, is SMSPP. It's the SMS point-to-point service, which we always neglect to add. So if you talk about SMS, that actually includes both the point-to-point and the cell broadcast service. And the main use case of this is for emergency and disaster warning. There used to be some other use cases, which I think are more artificial in nature and are mostly of historic interest these days. I'm not sure what... soccer results being broadcasted to people on their Nokia or Siemens phones in the 90s. But so it's really emergency notifications. And why is that? Well, particularly if you think of regions of the planet that have earthquakes or tsunamis resulting from earthquakes, the warning period you have is very short. So with earthquakes, I think the state of science is that you're happy if you get something like 4 seconds of advance notice that there will be an earthquake. Like it's in a definite prediction. And so it means you need to be really quick to get notification to as many people as possible so they can rush underneath tables and things like that. And using any kind of point-to-point mechanism, you can imagine how many SDCCH you can establish within those 4 seconds and how many point-to-point SMSs you can deliver. It's not realistic. So the only real way is to use a broadcast mechanism. And many different countries have specified emergency-related services on top. There is, in Europe, there's something called EU Alert, which then has national implementations like UK Alert or NL Alert. I guess you will know what the UK and NL is about. There's no DE Alert, as far as I know. Because German disaster, whatever authorities apparently think that an Katwarn-Ad app on Android is the way to go, which for sure will work in to notify lots of people in very short time. So there is in Japan, there is the ETWS, the Earthquake and Tsunami Warning System, and there is other systems in other parts of the planet. I think there's also a Korean implementation and some American CMAS, which has been renamed to EWS or WAS, I forgot. So how does SMS CB look like? We have a message that consists of a maximum of 15 pages, and each page has 82 bytes of payload data. So if you use the 7-bit alphabet, then you have 93 characters. If you use some other alphabets, as in SMS point-to-point, you of course have less space in there. The messages are so optimized that there is no A in the message anymore, so it's messages, which are broadcast on logical channels. And the logical channels are really more like an address. So you have like somewhere in the header you put 23, and then basically this message is in channel 23, and on the phone side you can then have logical filtering whether you're interested in 23 or not. And this logical channel or address determines what kind of message it is. And on older phones, those who are old enough of you will remember that you could actually select which cell broadcast groups to subscribe or not subscribe on old phones.
You can even choose language you would like to subscribe.
Sorry, you can? Yeah, okay. The comment was you could even choose the language in which you would like to subscribe. I haven't looked at that aspect yet, but yes, I know there is language indications in the SMSCB headers, so you can actually have messages in multiple languages. If you want to look more, learn more about this actual message structure, there is TS03.41 or 23.0.41, which describes that in detail. I haven't really studied that part in that much detail yet because, well, that's sort of, well, what's in there, okay. Fine, but I mean, I'm more interested in the transport and the network architecture. So, how does cell broadcast work as it's specified in GSM? Well, you have, I say, the user, in this case, that's the emergency service or whoever issues such a broadcast message, which is sent over a proprietary non-specified interface to the cell broadcast center, which somehow reminds you that there is like an external entity sending an SMS over a proprietary interface into the SMSC. So it's really very similar to point-to-point, but basically an unspecified interface. Then there is the cell broadcast center, the CBC. It's not the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. Then there's a protocol by which the CBC will forward those messages to the BSCs. You see, there's no MSC in that picture. So that's completely independent of the MSC. So your HLR can be down, your MSC can be down, you know, your SGS and everything can be down. As long as the BSCs are still alive and the CBC is alive, you can actually push those messages around. So the CBSP, this cell broadcast service protocol, then pushes it to the BSC, and the BSCs use special RSL messages to then push the messages to the BTSs, which then transmit it over the so-called CBCH, the cell broadcast channel, to the mobile station. Now, if we look at this in terms of a ladder diagram, it looks a little bit like this. It's exactly the same, just drawn as a ladder diagram. So we get some new message from the, actually it's called the CBE. It's a cell broadcasting entity. It's like a little bit like an ESME or something, if you think in SMS terms, which sends a new message into the CBC over this proprietary unspecified protocol. And it includes information like the duration, for how long time is this message valid, and in which geographic area should it be broadcast. The CBC then determines which BSCs are within that geographic region, and then issues so-called CBSB write replace requests to the BSC. And the BSC in turn then determines which BTSs are within that geographic region, and then it also performs scheduling, because if there's many different broadcast messages that you might want to send at the same time, of course there's some priorities and you need to pick and choose which to send when. And then it actually issues so-called RSL SMSCB commands to the BTSs. And the BTSs then will actually transmit the messages over the cell broadcast channel, and each 82 byte payload, which ends up in 88 byte with headers, is split into four blocks of each 22 bytes. And if you remember, 22 just fits exactly into the 23 byte MAC block size, and you know how it's transmitted over the radio interface. So you have these four blocks in the CBCH, and the BTS itself doesn't do any retransmit unless this RSL SMB CB command said this is a default message that you should transmit whenever you don't have anything else to transmit in the CBCH. Also, at times, the BTS can send CBCH load indications so that the BSC has an idea how much percent capacity of the downlink cell broadcast channel are currently utilized, which can help the BSC in this task of scheduling the different CBCH messages. So what do we have in Osmocom today? It's rather simplistic. Daniel and I were hacking at this, I don't know how many years ago, at Congress. Sorry? Yeah. What we have, we don't have a CBC, we don't have a CBSP, we don't have all that stuff. We just have, in BSC, we have a VTY command, which is a proprietary interface, by which we can insert a hex dump of an SMS cell broadcast message, which will then trigger a single SMS broadcast command to the BTS, and the BTS will then take care of this transmission. And this used to work once, but in absence of testing, it has broken over time. I fixed some parts of it for some BTS models again, it traditionally was not implemented on Osmo BTS TRX, but I added it, I think, at some point last year. Even that, what you see there, is not 100% working at this very point in time, even though it was working. How is the situation going to look like soon? Well, there is a funded project now by Prototype Fund that I applied for to complete the cell broadcast implementation in Osmocom. And that's to be completed in third quarter 2019. And it covers at least the full support for 2G and 3G. And if time permits, within that budget, also the 4G related part will be implemented. Of course, only up to the point where we send the respective messages to the MME, and you know, if there is no open source MME that can consume them, that's not in the scope of this project. So let's look at all the different functionalities required to achieve that. So in the BTS, and that, as I said, to a large extent exists already, basically what happens is that one SDCCH in an SDCCH 4 or SDCCH 8 is replaced with the CBCH. In the TDMA multiplex structure. And then you advertise the CBCH presence in the BCCH. Don't ask me which system information message it is, but somewhere in there you can indicate it. And then you receive these SMS broadcast commands from the BSC, where you need to divide these 88 bytes into 22 byte blocks. Then you transmit them in what's called a TS04.12 SMS broadcast request on the cell broadcast channel. So these, the encoding and everything is exactly like an SDCCH or like a BCCH or the CCCH. And the difference is just that it exists in downlink only, and you don't have anything in uplink during that time happening. On the BSC side, so as I said, on the BTS side, that exists at least for Sysmo BTS, and it should exist also for Osmo BTS TRX so far. It needs to be completed for all the other models and tested. On the BSC side, what we need to implement is this SMSCB protocol towards the CBC, and then we need to distribute the respective BTSs. I think since we don't really have a notion of geographic scope, we probably just push it to all the BTSs that are currently connected. We need to do some scheduling in case there's many different broadcasts, but that will be rather simplistic. As said, these days it's only emergencies really, so we don't really need to worry that there's like 15 different emergencies and they need to prioritize between them at a given point in time. And then we need to process these CBCH load indications, compute load averages, and perform a little bit of flow control so we don't, you know, overflow the CBCH in the BTS. There's also load status inquiries that the CBC can send and ask us basically, well, what's the load on the CBCH? Is there capacity for more or not? The CBC itself will be completely new, Osmo CBC program, which has the following functions. It receives SMSCB from the external users, which is the emergency services. Receive those, we have to invent some protocol, will be probably something rather simplistic. In the CBC, I'm not sure. But yeah, I haven't really thought too much about it. Maybe, yeah, I don't want to comment on that. That will be seen once it's in development. We then need to distribute them for the BSCs. Well, have maybe some notion of geographic scope where you can see, well, this is where the BSCs have coverage area, and then also handle this expiration in terms of time, so that when the timeout as specified by the user has expired, that we remove the messages from these BSCs so that the BSCs don't send it to the BTS anymore and the transmission stops. There was a question there. Do you have a microphone? Yes. You have to switch, move the switch up. Yeah. Yes.
No. Yeah. Okay. Did you think about the possibility to actually add that into MSC together with a VTY command or something like similar to what we had in BSC? So, I have the feeling it's good because then you can send it to all BSCs because the MSC knows about all BSCs there. So, I mean, it can be so sort of having an internal one and then an external one like we have for SMSC.
I didn't really think about it. Of course, we could. I mean, I think the only real option we have is to run the entire CBC inside the MSC. Because, of course, every BSC only connects to only one. Strictly speaking, the CBC needs to know all the BSCs because the TCP connections are originating from the cell broadcast center to the BSC and not the other way around. That's how it's specified, at least. So it could be implemented there, but the point of this project is also that this can be useful even outside of Osmocom, right? If we implement a cell broadcast center that speaks CBSP to BSCs and has some external interface, then that can be used on any proprietary GSM network out there because it just uses a specified protocol. I intentionally would want to keep it separate, but maybe we can have some intelligent mechanism by which, like over control interfaces, so it can query the list of BSCs from Osmo MSC or something like that. But conceptually, I think makes sense.
Yeah, I was just thinking as having also the MSC being one possible client to that interface.
That, of course, would also work, that you can basically, on the VTY, issue a cell broadcast command when the MSC would send it to the CBC and the CBC would send it to the BSCs. How does it look on the radio interface? Let's skip that. The RSL broadcast command, I think also we can, as I said, it can be either default or a non-default message with 88 octets. The CBSP protocol, what kind of procedures do we have there? It's spoken on an unnamed interface. It's quite funny. There is no acronym for the interface, actually. It's just always called the interface between the CBC and the VSC. There is no... everything all right? Yeah. There is no formal syntax description. It's a good old human readable table in some Word document specification. And it runs over TCP port 48049. Interestingly, over TCP, and even on GSM, it's spoken over TCP. But of course, then they assume in the original specs that you do that TCP IP over PPP over a serial line, right? Because the BSC doesn't have any IP connectivity natively. So that's sort of how it's specific interest. Well, at least they didn't use, X25 or whatever, some kind of, you know, frame relay or whatever, and specified it over TCP. There's a couple of procedures. It's actually not just the key procedures, it's actually all the procedures that exist. There's a write replace procedure, which is basically, well, either you write a new message or it's like create or replace, I would call it. There's a kill procedure, which is funnily named, which is basically delete. You will see there's some interesting development there. This load status inquiry, well, the name says it all, and the message status query, which basically gives you information about whether or not it has been broadcast. There's an optional set DRX procedure, which relates to, well, some optional thing we won't implement about the discontinuous receive cycle. There's a reset procedure, which, like in all the interfaces, if one of the two sides dies or loses state, you can reset the interface state and let the other side know that it's gone. Now, that was all 2G. Now, in 3G, of course, it's a completely different thing, as we know. First of all, it's not a cell broadcast, it's a service area broadcast. The SAB, not to mix up with an SAP, a service access point. So, again, you have this proprietary interface to a cell broadcast center, which has retained its name, like the MSC has also retained its name. But then there is a new protocol called the SABP, the Service Area Broadcast Protocol, which is spoken to the RNCs. And the RNCs then again transmitted over IUB to the node Bs, which then transmitted over the broadcast message channel on the common traffic channel, the CTCH, to the user equipment. And if you look at it, it's extremely different from 2G. The diagram looks exactly the same, just that some acronyms are replaced.
Okay, is the equivalent in H and B for femtocells?
Yeah, so let's say the Nano 3G, for example, they supposedly implement cell broadcast support. We haven't tested it yet, but at least the data sheet says yes, we do. So we should be able to actually test all of this with our 3G equipment. Yeah, so as you see, it's the same thing, but with other acronyms. And actually, there's some slight differences there. And the differences are that actually you see here there is exactly the same message between the RNC and the node B and the node B and the UE. This is due to the different level of functional split in 2G and 3G, where the node B really is a very dumb transceiver between a wired interface and a wireless interface. It doesn't really do much intelligence itself. And that's why actually the entire scheduling and whatever is done already in the RNC, and this is really just relaying from a wire to a wireless interface. So the node B really doesn't have any functionality in this. It's completely transparent and it just passes it from left to right and that's it. The RNC pretty much does what the BSC does with the additional functionality of doing the low-level scheduling, which the BTS is doing in 2G, but now it's doing the RNC here. And in the cell broadcast center, well, it's exactly what it needs to do in 2G, but of course there's a new protocol which is doing exactly the same thing, which is the SABP protocol, which is spoken on an interface that now has a name, that's called the IUBC interface. It's specified in AS1, as everything in 3G had to be specified in AS1 using basic packed encoding rules. And originally, it was transported over something even more obscure than IP over PPP, and that is over LCAP, over SAAL, over AAL5, over ATM. That's ATM. Later, it was adapted to TCP. You can find some sources on the net that some equipment vendors also implemented over UDP or over SCTP. I don't know why one would want to do that, but well, the spec says it's TCP, so we'll implement it over TCP. Can somebody please take care of the guy who is taking the lunch? It's typically established in the CBC to RNC direction. So. Again, this sort of opposite direction. The procedures are, well, the same, except did anyone notice what's the difference in the procedures here? DRX. Yeah, the DRX has been removed, correct. Max gets some bonus points. Oh, there is this one. That's the procedures that are there. I'm not sure actually if it's still that kill procedure, because at some point in the evolution from 2G to 4G, the kill procedure was renamed in something less lethal. I actually found that quite funny that in 2G, you know, this was specified in the. So. That was renamed at some point. So if we look at an IUH-based interface with an HNB gateway, that's exactly the same situation from the CBC point of view. You talk the IUBC protocol. It's just that then you're not talking to an RNC on the other side, but you're talking to the home node B gateway, to the HNB GW, which then takes care of distributing it to the individual home node Bs. If we look at 4G before we can finally close this session, it's rather similar again. So we have some external user that over a proprietary protocol talks to the CVC, and the CVC then has yet a new protocol called the SPC interface with an SPC AP protocol talking to the MNE, and the MME will distribute it over S1 to the eNode B, which then transports it over something that I didn't really, it's some NAS message probably some, no, it's actually in the system information blocks. Yes, I actually I found that later, so it's becomes part of the system information that are being broadcast by LTE in this case.
Are they using that for 5G? Because it starts with G, so it should be both, right, if it's 4G?
Where is G? I'm saying the generic cell broadcast that we had before in LTE was replaced by something that is dedicated for emergency warnings only. So basically they removed all the general purpose use cases and said, no, this is only about emergencies, which immediately reflects itself in this message where it's no longer a write replace message, but it's now a write replace warning message. To make sure, and also, see on S1 AP, it's a write replace warning request and an SIB warning. But again, the same logic, the same. Welcher Name? Dann bist du dann. Ja. What's the problem with the backdoor? System Information Block. So, it's exactly the same logic again. So the replace procedure, it has been renamed a bit, but otherwise it's the same conceptually. The functionality is also again very much same. So the eNode B receives these messages and it schedules them to transmission over system information blocks. The MMC is doing very much what the VSC or RNC was doing, but it doesn't need to do any of the scheduling because that's inside the eNode B, and it's basically just a distribution function. So it receives a write replace over SPC AP, and then it retransmits that over S1 AP. And the CVC is basically accidentally doing the same as in 2G or 3G, but has this additional protocol, which again is specified in ASN1, is now operated over SCTP in port 29168. And you have, again, a subset of the procedures. So which procedure was removed this time? Yeah, now it's the stop warning, but I think actually there is something else. The reset procedure has been removed, interestingly, for whatever reason. That's basically how it works on 4G. Interestingly, looking at Wireshark to help us with the development of that, we have a dissector for the TS04.12 messages. We also have an SABP, that's 3G dissector. We also have an SBCAP dissector, that's 4G. But for CBSB for 2G, there was none. I wrote one last year, but it's not really tested yet because we don't really implement those interfaces yet. So hence, it's not in mainline. But somebody also sent me a CBSB trace from a real-world network, and I think apart from one or two mistakes, it was decoded. Fine. So yeah, if you want to read specs, these are the pointers. And yeah, as I said, by later this year, we should have all of this implemented and working. Good. Questions?
There are these geographical scopes, and it's not clear for me how they are translated into the set of base stations. That what is, for example, format of this geographical scope, and how BSTs know which base stations to select?
Well, there is sort of, I mean, I don't know how it's encoded in these protocols. I haven't looked at that detail yet. I know that in, let's say, location-based services and other things, there's actually a way how to encode GPS positions or polygons or, you know, like geographical areas. And there is sort of the implicit assumption, even though it's not required anywhere, that some entity, whether it's the OMC or whatever in the network, will know where exactly the location areas are and that somehow this can be translated. But it's not standardized or specified anywhere. Okay.
So I'm just taking a look at its pretty much stock Android phone SMS app, and it seems to have two configuration sections. One is entitled Emergency Alerts, and the other is entitled SMS Cell Broadcast. And within the SML Cell Broadcast, there is an add channel ID function,
yes,
right? And the Emergency Alerts is just either on or off. So is that emergency alerts, is that relating to the 4G only stuff?
No.
Or no? Well, what's the difference
no.
between these
it's
two?
It's basically just paper? One particular channel inside SMSCB that where the payload format is structured and not unstructured text. So there's some additional header and some additional information and a long field for signature that shall not be used. So it's basically an application on top. So you say like one of these channels of SMSCB has another protocol layer on top, and that's these emergency systems.
Okay, just I don't know if anybody might be referencing their own phone, looking at the talk stream. There's also an area info channel specific ID 50 enabled or disabled function. What's the functionality of that? Any idea?
I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. There's and from phone to phone, so there's many different configuration options that some phones have and some not. And I mean, in the US, it's legally required that presidential level alerts may not be disabled on the phone. So the president must always be able to reach you. Should be the other way around, huh? from which? Yeah, yeah. I think it was the current president, right? It was
yes,
recently. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They tested it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know. Right.
Years ago, I think O2 sent like the location of their base stations via cell broadcast to everyone. I think that was the same mechanism, right?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So indeed, some operator in Germany used to do that. And as I said, some others had some services where they would broadcast soccer results. And I don't know what other use cases people came up with. Weather forecasts, I think, was also at some point. Yeah, but that's an emergency somehow. Not a natural. Yeah, yeah, the area code was, Vodafone did that for a long time to broadcast the current area code, as in the landline area code of the region in which you're in, because that would have a different rate. It's more like a local call as opposed to a long distance call outside of that area. So, yeah, these were the marvelous use cases. Yeah, microphone?
So the connection is always from CBC towards RNC equivalent, right?
Yes.
So as long as we can scan Shodan or whatever and find open ports, we can just send some useful information to people.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, good. Then we conclude that with some delay in the schedule. Huh? Yeah.
In terms of testing this now with current Sysmo BTSA and Osmo BSC and the blob that one would need to, do you have some tool to generate that? Or is there details on the wiki? Or?
I'm not sure. I think Daniel once wrote a small Python hack that generates these presidential and whatever alert messages. And then it generates the hex stump that you copy and paste into the VTY. That was what we tested. But it was broken for years in Osmo VTS until it was fixed again at some point last year. So depending on the software you're running, it may not be working. Okay, good. Then, thanks.